morning in progress.
But thank you for coming, and thank you for coming to this worship today and communion we're looking forward to. So we're going to start with a real, real old song that maybe some of you know. And it's Sweet By and By.
Did you see?
Yeah.
Thank you.
thank and praise the team for being here this morning. And thanks for everybody coming today. Just want you to know, men's breakfast was yesterday. What do you think happened, ladies? It was a record attendance. How many men showed up, do you think? 18. 18. Good. I got to watch my grandson eat 5 pancakes. He says he loves pancakes. And so what I ordered, I made sure I ordered 2 pancakes, and then he took those 2 on his 3, and he ate 5. And I'm going like, oh.
And he was done before anybody else.
And yeah, he was done. Then he went to his technology right away. Yeah, that was great. All you guys that came, thank you so much. And we still got to beat the winning record, but we're on our way there. It was so fun to see everyone show up yesterday. You did receive a bulletin as you came in today, and we'd like to make sure we recognize those that are here because of the summer that has hit us. We're in the summer months, and there's some that come back to the lakes for the summer and to the cabins, and we're glad that you are here with us this morning as well. As we look at the bulletin today, I just want to remind you that there is a ice cream. Oh, sorry, well, it's only a pie auction out at Indium. No, there's an ice cream social out there. I see that. So ice cream social today out at Indium Bible Camp, which is a ways from here. You have to go find out where Waddington is. Wallingford, there we go. Wallingford, and it's to the east somewhere out there by the lake. There's not that many lakes in Iowa, you know. In Minnesota, you have a problem. But it's by the lake. But anyway, it'll probably be marked, or you probably know how to get there. And that starts at, the program is at 3:30 this afternoon. They then have a supper with made right sandwiches or whatever you want to call that. We call them in North Dakota sloppy joes or chili burgers. But made right has no sauce. It's just plain hamburger and falls all over your lap. I don't know how you came up with that, but it's okay. It's good, very good sandwich, and then ice cream follows that as well from 4 to 6 p.m. There's a pie auction at 6 o'clock. It's a free will offering. If you can make it, look forward to having you be a part of that. This Tuesday is a women's Bible study that's starting at 9:30. It deals with anxiety. It's only three lessons. Carol Banta is leading that Bible study for you ladies, and that is dealing with anxiety, so there's nothing to be anxious about these days, is there? There's all kinds of things. Not just what's going on in our country, but probably things going on health-wise in some of your homes and some of you people as well, that you're going to see the doctor more than you've seen your friends. And it feels that way sometimes, doesn't it? But that's at 9:30, this starting this Tuesday, and then starting at on Thursday at from noon to 1 o'clock, I was starting a Bible study on 1 Timothy. I'll be leading that on this coming Thursday, so getting back into the Bible study. So we hope that Elmer and Norma can make it, and Bruce and Donna Osher can make it, as well as Karen Weber. Some of you others. Cheryl, you've been here a few times. You should bring Dean with you. I don't know why he's laughing, but it'd be great to have Dean. So if Dean shows up, Chuck says he'll be there. Right, Chuck?
What?
Moving on. Church Council does meet this on the 14th, June 14th, on a Tuesday night. Just keep that in mind. Wednesday night, fellowship coming up. The blessing box, there's a lot of things still in the bulletin on the other side. There's some other things, too, that you may find interesting to read. And we are just glad that we can inform you that there are things happening here at Harbor of Joy that sometimes you don't always know what's going on. But that's why we give you the bulletin, so you always know what's happening. If you've got any questions about anything, you can should talk to me after the service, talk to Charlie or anybody else. If they don't know, I should know, but I don't always know everything. So let's have a word of prayer together, and we'll turn it back over to our praise team. Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for bringing us together. Thank you for a wonderful trip. I got to see my mom in Turtle Lake, North Dakota. And Lord, it was so much fun to drive there because the whole state is green. Last year when we went, it was all brown and no rain. But this time, Lord, we even got to see some rain. And everything is so green that I go like, so that's what North Dakota looks like when it gets moisture. And so we're thankful for being with her and reconnecting. And thank you that she is on Zoom today. And she doesn't want anyone to see her face on Zoom. But I still love it when we know that she's on and that we can wave to her as well. Lord, be with us this morning as we come together to worship you and come before your table where we get to spend time one-on-one with you and allow you, Lord, to work in our hearts and in our lives today. Be with all aspects of this service. Be with those that you are praying for. Many things going on there. We just pray, Lord, for the things that are being planned for Harbor of Joy this coming summer, beginning this month as well. And that you would speak to our hearts here this morning and all that is said, all that is done. That we would leave here different than the way that we came. Lord, that we spend time not just going to church, Lord, but we spend time with you, knowing that you love us, you will forgive us of our sins, you will empower us to live for you each and every day. And so we thank you for those that are here this morning, and may you continue to work in each pew here this morning. We pray in Jesus' name.
One more addendum to the announcements. The Harbor of Joy have two full tables at the Women's Conference at Old Boji. We've got 18 women going, plus we have another table that's almost full. We have to get our tickets tomorrow at 9:30. So we have three spaces left and we have three tables. So if you're interested, let me know and we can arrange for that.
When is that, Sharon?
August the 3rd, I think. It's the first Wednesday of August.
Okay. Thank you.
At 1 o'clock at Arrowwood.
I don't know anything.
Thank you.
singing this morning, and may you know that you can hold on to his hand. It's not so much that what you hold on, but he's holding on to you. That makes a bigger impression and a bigger thing than anything else as well. God is holding every hand that's here this morning as we trust in him by faith. It is communion this Sunday. There's also Pentecost, day of Pentecost, that we'll talk more about here in a little bit. And there's a brief order of confession and forgiveness during this time of communion. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we're liars. If we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let's take some time in silence, that you would have this time to just talk to the Lord, confess your sins, whatever the Holy Spirit brings to your heart and mind this morning, and give them to him. Ask for his forgiveness. Lord, sometimes silence is something that makes us very uncomfortable. We live busy lives. We like things happening around us, or like to be listening to something in the background, or something immediate. And we thank you for the silence. As you work in our hearts and our lives this morning, showing us our sin, which is never pleasant, showing us where we have wronged someone, may have even been our wife, our husband, our kids, grandkids, on and on it goes. Maybe it's even our neighbor next door, or whoever our neighbor is, which is everyone. Lord, thanks for loving us and caring for us in spite of who we are as sinners. We are grateful knowing that you forgive us of whatever sin we have done or are part of. But we pray that today would be one of those days that we would say, Lord, I need your power to break the chains of sin of this area of my life, whatever that area is, or something you find yourself doing over and over again that you don't like. And so we say, most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed.
By what we have done, by what we have left undone, we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in your mercy, you have given us your Son, who has laid down his life for us, so that we may have forgiveness for our sins. Amen. Verses 1 through 8, and then verse 13, Acts chapter 2. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. How many were there? 120 people were in one place together. And suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other language, other tongues, as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. And when they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard them speaking in his own language. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Are not all these men who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in his own native language?" And it gives you a list of where they were from and the people where they lived. We go to verse 13. Even though they were amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" And then some, however, made fun of them and said, "They've had too much wine." Heavenly Father, thank you for this great event that took place. And we see that there are some different views and some different ways of looking at what is taking place. And we just pray today, Lord, that you'd help us to see the truth of what is in your word, what it means for us here today, as it did back then. And so use your word today in our hearts and our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Pentecost. You want the short version or the long version? I see that. Okay, the short version could be this. Luke is the writer of the book of Acts. And sometimes you see the Acts of the Apostles. That's kind of how the book is referred to. There's another way, probably, in which it would be better to refer to the book of Acts as the Acts of the Apostles, as they were empowered by the Holy Spirit and what they did because of that. Pentecost, in a short way to say it, is a day in which the Holy Spirit came and indwelt every believer from that time until today, up to today. Anyone who becomes a believer today invites Jesus into their life, and by faith believes in him, the Holy Spirit comes and lives inside of us. This didn't happen before. Jesus was with the 12 disciples. He was there in person. They saw what he did. They saw miracles of the people that were touched by his miracles. He was there presently with them. But remember last week, Jesus ascended into heaven. He's not with them anymore, but he's going to come differently. His body is different after the resurrection. As he said, wait until the Comforter comes, the Counselor comes, the Spirit of Truth comes. The disciples had no idea how long they had to wait for that. But they said, Jesus said to wait until this happens, and they'll know it. Whenever God does something, he does it in a way that people know it's him. It's not man-made, but it's God. And so when the Holy Spirit comes, we see some of the things that take place here in our text today. The sound of a wind. You know what wind sounds like, don't you? Can you imagine? Of course, there's probably been times when you've been in church and you've heard the wind. outside, you're glad you're inside, especially ladies that like your hair always where you want it to be. But it was the sound of a wind, a violent wind, and it came from heaven. And it filled the whole house where they were sitting in. And then there's something else that took place. There's like tongues of fire that came and rested on each of those that were there. Now, I go back to Sunday school. Going through Sunday school, there was sometimes a little lesson that showed a new cake. Maybe it was Vacation Bible School. But you have a little tongue of a flame, and you put it over the tops of the heads of everybody in the picture. And so something incredible happened that they've never, ever seen before. The tongues of fire that rested upon each person that was there. It didn't burn them. It's just something new. Of course, remember, the Christian faith is new at this time. There's nothing like this before. There's Judaism, and there would be, worshiping other gods that other nations did, other countries did. But as far as the Christian faith just beginning, interesting things take place where God makes sure to let people know that he's doing a new thing. And so we've got the sound of wind, we've got tongues of fire, and then we have the other thing that happens is that most of these people are from Galilee. And here they started talking in a different language, but they could be understood by those that were there and wondering, now how can you speak our language because we know you're not from our country? And so there's three things that happened on Pentecost. Well, pick it forward. The fourth thing is the Holy Spirit comes down and indwells every believer. Very important. Now, for a Jew, Pentecost is not something new. In the Old Testament, they have Pentecost, but it's referred to as the Feast of Weeks. If you'll read about the Feast of Weeks, that is where it's right in line with Pentecost. The Feast of Weeks basically is at the end of the Feast of Weeks is where they would bring two loaves of bread. It's got yeast in it. They give it to the high priest that he would wave it and have some little ceremony over that. But it was the second or the third most important of the feasts? It's right up there. The Jews would be very much knowing that what was going on here, why they did it. But here, Jesus comes and uses this. I should say God comes and uses Pentecost in a whole new way that they're not familiar with. But very important for the beginning of the Christian faith. Because what happens on this day that it talks about in the second chapter of Acts, there are 3,000 people in Jerusalem that are converted and come to believe in Christ as Lord and Savior. 3,000 on this day. You think that would get the attention of the hierarchy in Jerusalem? There's like 3,000 people. It's like no matter where you go, you're running into people who are talking about Jesus Christ and the difference that he has made in their lives. We read a little bit further into Acts and find that there's 2,000 more that come to believe. So there's 5,000 people that come to believe in a very short time in Jerusalem, of all places, that Jesus is the Christ. The Messiah that they've been looking for has come, but not everybody believed that. And they still don't today. So when God does something, he makes sure he does something that we never forget, and he definitely gets our attention. Pentecost is one of those things where the fulfillment of Joel's prophecy, and Joel is one of the minor prophets, second chapter of Joel, verses 28 to 32, we find that this is a prophecy that Joel made hundreds of years before, that now is taking place right before their very eyes. It's a prophecy that is fulfilled in what is taking place. Not everyone is impressed, like I've said before. Actually, the last verse that I read here today, it says that some made fun of it. Now, you can expect that. If you're a believer here today, if you become a Christian, expect there's going to be people who are going to make fun of you because of that act. There are some who will say, oh yeah, he's on the wagon now. What does that mean? Probably means that somebody's not drinking anymore. We're on the wagon. Why are they on the wagon? Well, they said they found religion. It's not finding religion. It's that Jesus found you. And he's forgiven you of your sins. And he loves you. He's given you a whole new life to live you never had before. Because the Holy Spirit is one who gives power to break those chains of sin that are going on in our lives. Without the Holy Spirit, we could not live as Christians. It's the Holy Spirit that works in us and through us. An example is this. Isn't this a nice jacket? Tell this jacket to do something. No matter what you say to the jacket, it's just going to be here in my hand. It won't do a thing for you. But watch this. When the Holy Spirit comes, he fills us. It's like I can fill this jacket. Now I can live for the Lord, and this jacket becomes more than just a jacket hanging on my hand. Because it becomes someone that you meet. There's someone that cares and loves you and shows that to you. That's what the Holy Spirit does. And the whole purpose of the Holy Spirit is to always point people to Jesus. Whatever he does, it is to make us more and more like Jesus. So have you become more and more like Jesus since you first came to believe in him? No matter how many years ago it was? Because if you can't say, you know, I'm about the same as I always have been, it can't be that way. If the Holy Spirit is alive and working in your life, you're different today than you were when you first met Jesus. There should be more depth in your spiritual life than that you had before. Before you didn't care. Now you care. So where are you at? What's the Lord been doing in your heart and in your life these days? Because he wants to make you more like his son. Are you listening? Are you saying, Lord, I'm out of my comfort zone, but I'll trust you. And he will work as he always has done. So the Holy Spirit comes and lives inside every believer. That's the whole message of Pentecost. Before this, the Holy Spirit, no one really knew much about the Holy Spirit. But Jesus said, he says this in Acts chapter 1, verse 8, I believe. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And then you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem. And in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. To be a missionary and to go to some other country. It's the Holy Spirit that puts that desire in your life. And God will take care of the details. Think of all the missionaries and stories that they have of like, how in the world did you end up going abroad? Sometimes it's like, how in the world did you ever become a pastor? Good question. I never wanted to be one. God, through the Holy Spirit, changes you where you realize, hey, I'm tired of running away from you. Do what you want to do, but because I can't do without you. God's never failed. He's been faithful, even when I haven't been faithful. People will make fun of you. And it said here, verse 13, that there are some who said they've had too much wine to drink. This is like at 9 o'clock in the morning when this takes place. Way too early for people to be three sheets in the wind, drunker than skunks. And so you got people who will make up things or people who will say things about you that aren't true. And you're going to have to learn how to live with that. You're just going to have to say, well, think what you want to think. But I'm going to live for Jesus. When you look at Acts chapter 2, verses 42 to 47, you'll notice what takes place early on in the beginning of the church. There would be no Christian church except for the Holy Spirit to come at Pentecost. Because it's his involvement in the lives of people, of converting them to be Christians, and then how did they live their lives after they came to believe? And you'll find out in the verses 42 to 47 in chapter 2 of Acts. You know, the first thing you see there is that there was a hunger for God's word. People wanted a Bible study. People wanted to learn more about what was in the Bible and what God was up to and what he's done in the past and what he's doing today. There's a desire for fellowship. And so there's an encouragement that comes with fellowship, with being with other believers. And people on the outside are looking in and are watching, these are some peculiar people. They're different. Why in the world do they even go to church and be with these other strange ducks that are there? But they like what they see. And they see a difference. If they don't see a difference when they come to church in your life, guess what? Why come? It's no different than being a part of a social club somewhere in this community. Everybody likes to get together. But what makes them different is that they loved God. They loved Christ. They knew the changes that he brought into their lives. They loved being together. They loved talking about Christianity. They loved talking about spiritual things. Matter of fact, they even prayed together. Some silent, some spoke. It doesn't matter. Anything is they desire to have prayer together. I asked Pat Arrows. I mean, I kind of know who shows up for praying. But we have that in the bulletin every Sunday. There's a prayer group that meets. Her, Nancy Letcher, Kathy, Hermes.
Karen Dockin.
Karen Dockin. How many come? Four. You know, in the early church, people wanted to come together to pray. I would guarantee you that if I said, okay, we're going to have a prayer meeting tonight at Harbor of Joy, I could about tell you how many would show up. Maybe a handful. In the early church, if you said you had a prayer meeting, you better look for a pretty big room. People would come and pray. So we just look at those verses in chapter 2 of Acts, you begin to see a lot of the things that made these people look different, and that they lived differently than the rest of the people did, and it piqued everyone's interest of saying, yeah, there's people even selling different things and gave the money for someone else to meet a need that they had. You know, they had garage sales. But they didn't pocket the money for themselves. They thought of someone else that could use some help. And so they sold what they had to give to them, to meet needs. Always looking for needs. The blessing box. That's to meet needs. You don't always know who comes in the blessing box and takes out of there what they need. But it sure is being used, right, David?
Yeah.
It is, yeah. And it's not up to us to say, who are we being taken for a ride? Are we being used? People have to answer to God themselves for that. But we provide help to those who want it. So I just want to close with this. When you find in the book of Acts on the day of Pentecost and the things that follow early on in the early church, is this what Harbor of Joy looks like? Are these the kinds of things that we are actively pursuing and being a part of as a church in this community? Because God has some great things that He wants to do in and through this church and in this community. And we just find in the scriptures of some of the things that He does. The Holy Spirit is at work in doing these things in and through our lives. Now, it's not to make us feel guilty, but it's to convict us to push on, to go forward, rather than just stay where we are or just get lackadaisical, complacent. So if you look at Revelation chapter 3, verses 15 through 17, it says this. It's talking about the Laodicean church, the last of the seven churches. It gives a description of what this church will, what it looks like. It says this. Let me find it in the Bible. I thought I had it typed out here, but I don't. Revelation 3. When they say 15 through 17, it just says this. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. You say, I am rich. I have acquired wealth and do not need a thing. But you do not realize that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. We go on to verse 20, which we've heard many times before. Jesus says, here I am. I stand at the door and knock. It's the door of your heart. You see the picture of Jesus knocking on the door? If you notice, there is no handle on the outside. It has to be opened from the inside. But He's knocking on the door. Someone has to open that door from the inside. Just like in your heart and your life, you've got to open it by faith to Him. And He says that, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. He will come in, but he will not come unless he's asked. Welcome to come in. You know that if you go to anybody's house and you knock on the door, you ring the doorbell, you stay outside until somebody answers the door. And you stay there until they say, well, why don't you come on in? And then you go, oh, good, I thought you'd never say that. Jesus wants to come into your heart and life today. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for Pentecost because it has really changed the world. You think of the many people through the centuries, Lord, that have listened invited you and followed you to places they never ever would have thought of going themselves. But you have provided for them in miraculous ways. And you've used them. How else would people hear about Jesus unless someone goes to them? And Lord, there are some that, especially in America, Americans are really good at wanting to see results. If somebody goes as a missionary and they go like, well, I haven't really reached anyone that I know of as far as coming to believe in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, and their lives have changed, and they're just really gung-ho about Bible study and wanting to memorize scripture and singing songs. And for some, Lord, it can be years before they see a convert. And they've been faithful in just spreading the word. And that's what you ask of us, just to be faithful. You will produce the results. And so, Lord, even if it takes years, help us to be faithful. Only the Holy Spirit, which is one of His gifts, that calls us to be faithful, and only He can make that happen in our lives. Faithfulness to You and Your Word, and to follow You faithfully all the days of our lives. So may You use Your Word today, Lord, on this Pentecost Sunday, and may we give You thanks. Give You thanks for looking for that lost sheep that was me. Looking for many lost sheep that listened to the Good Shepherd and are following Him today. So Lord, maybe if we haven't done so already, and if we hear You calling our name or nudging us somehow, some way this morning, may we invite You into our lives to be the Lord and Savior that You are. And so help us, Lord, as we pray Your prayer that we taught Your disciples to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Let us stand and recite the Apostles' Creed together before we take communion. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. May be seated. Just want to explain to you a little bit about communion. If you are new here, just want you to know that you are more than welcome to participate, to be a part of taking communion with us. We believe it's an open communion, which means you do not have to be a member of Harbor of Joy. You can come as you are. There are two stations. One station is you come up here and you'll receive the elements. If you do not want wine, you just hold your hand like this and you'll be given grape juice. And if you want to come up front to another station up here, you will be served communion. You can kneel, you can stand at the altar, however you want to do that. You can just spend as much time up there as you want so that you feel you need, and then go back and be seated. You'll be dismissed by an usher when they come forward, and that's kind of how we do it here today. Before you come, just want you to be aware of that on the night in which Jesus was betrayed, He took bread, and when He had broken the bread, He gave it to His disciples and He said to them, "This is My body, eat it, and to do this remembrance of Me." Fully charged. He then took the cup. And when he had drank it, gave thanks to the Lord, to the Father. He said to his disciples, take the cup, drink all of it. It is for the forgiveness of sins. And do this in remembrance of me. And we're to do this until he comes again. There's something about communion that God does a work in us that we don't always see. But one of the things is that he strengthens our faith. That's why he wants us to come, freely come, to strengthen us in the places where we need to be strengthened. Where before we could not say no to sin, because of communion we can say now, no, I don't want to do that. I don't want to go there. I just would rather not take part in that. Because I'm a Christian. I believe in Jesus as my Lord and Savior. That's what makes me different from all others. So we'll have the ones who are the servers, they come. And once they are set, then the usher will come forward. Let's turn this thing off so I don't make a mess.
Thank you.
our crucified and risen Lord Jesus Christ, who has now given you his holy body and blood, through which he has made full satisfaction for all your sins, may he strengthen and preserve you in true faith and everlasting life. Amen. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.
Why don't you stand for our last one?
Thanks be to God.